Do you understand how dark it is? How far down the line we are? How late it is?
You know, I saw an article quoting Richard Stallman about attacks on the internet and its infrastructure and free speech. And I told my producer to get him on. And when the two IT guys here at the office found out about it, they were very giddy today, because this guy is quite a bigwig in the architecture of browsers, the internet, you name it. Richard Stallman, GNU Linux inventor. Richard Matthew Stallman, often abbreviated RMS, is an American software freedom activist, hacker, and software developer. In September 83, he launched the GNU Project to create a free Unix-like operating system and has been the project's lead architect and organizer. With the launch of the GNU Project, he started the free software movement and in October 1985 set up the Free Software Foundation. You know, if I go over his whole bio, we'll never get to him, but this is one of the, you know, I know they say Al Gore invented the internet, even though it was around, you know, 30 years ago. And I know they say he probably invented the moon, actually, and the galaxy. But, you know, when we talk about some of the folks that have actually really contributed to the infrastructure of the free web as we know it, this guy's certainly an icon in what we know as the modern web, Richard Stallman. I want to get him on because they're trying to get rid of net neutrality. They're trying to change how the web works. The head of cybersecurity quit 2 months ago. We talked to him. He says he's not ready to come on the air right now. He's behind the scenes stuff, but he said the feds are taking it over. The Pentagon's taking over the web. And then it came out in the news that they are taking over the actual hubs of even smaller, internet telecom systems. So to try to break all this down with us is Richard Stallman. Richard, so much is going on, and we've got you for the about 45 minutes or so. It's great to have you here with us.
Well, I'm pleased to have a chance again.
You bet. You've got the floor. What do you think's most important? I mean, you've dedicated your entire professional career to liberty and freedom on this wonderful thing we call the internet. How did it start? Where are we going?
Well, first, I have to correct a couple of things. I've never worked on web browsers myself. I'm happy to say that there are some free, freedom-respecting web browsers, but I didn't write any of them.
Now, what I meant was just setting up an infrastructure, but I mean the group they have here that you set up is involved in a whole bunch of stuff, is my point, but go ahead.
Yes. We developed, first of all, the GNU operating system, which gets used together with Linux, the kernel, and that's the main freedom-respecting operating system that lets you use your computer without handing over control to some company. Now, we know that Microsoft Windows has a back door that allows Microsoft to forcibly impose changes in software without asking permission of the supposed owner of the machine. And we know that macOS has a similar backdoor, except that it's Apple that can forcibly impose changes. They can change anything they want in the software, which means they can wipe the floor with whoever's using that machine. So, in effect, these two systems have no security at all against that particular company.
And then we see U.S. senators coming out, just a real-life example of this, saying, oh, we'll just make it where if we think you downloaded music illegally or videos, no court, no jury, we'll just, quote, fry your computer. That's where all this remote access comes in. And there's so many things we could talk about. Please continue with, because I've seen them now trying to move towards making it where everything you have is on a remote server. Your computers, are no longer even really operable by themselves. They just become terminals. Please continue.
Well, these are both part of the desire to regain control over what we do with our computers and with the internet. And these are not the only ways. Of course, they're bad. In fact, a PC today, any PC today, is pretty powerful compared with the machines that people were using 10 years ago. And the disks that they're making today are so big, why would you ever feel you need to store your data someplace other than in your own computer or your own office or your own bedroom? You can't even get the disks nowadays that I used to think were very big 10 years ago. Now they don't make anything that small. So we should resist this tendency. And I think it's a sort of marketing hype phenomenon, and buzzwords are being invented, including the term cloud computing, which is so nebulous that nobody can really tell what it means. It means a different thing depending on who's using it. So it's not really a coherent thing to talk about, and so I won't say anything about it. But storing some data on servers is not necessarily a bad thing when it's part of a, when you're publishing it. When it's, for instance, something you want to put on a web server so everybody can see it, well, there's no great harm that's possible there. The worst that anyone could do to it is delete it and turn it off. And you'd know that. Of course, mainly that's likely to happen if somebody with power is mistreating you, but they can always do that. So the point is, there's no particular harm from, if you want to publish something, from putting it on some server somewhere. But when you don't want to publish it, then the only way to keep it privately is to keep it in your disk.
Well,
and to use your copy of free software to do your computing.
Well, Mr. Stallman, you know, we can kind of get into the detailed minutiae of this, and I want to do that in the limited time we have with you today, and we respect your time. How about the big picture of what the infrastructure, the architecture of the web has been, what the establishment and, you know, is fighting to change it over to where they have control versus what you, you know, somebody who's really fought for, you know, true freedom on the internet, should be?
Well, we see a lot of ways in which people are trying to take more control. Software as a service is one of these ways. In order for you to have control of your computing, you've got to do it with your copy of a free program. If the program you use isn't free, freedom respecting that is, that means the developer controls it and the users don't. So that way you've lost control over your computing. But if you're doing your computing in somebody else's server, you've also lost control because that means you're using his copy of the program, whatever program it is, not your copy. So he has control over it and you don't. So the way to prevent that from happening to you is insist on doing your computing in your computer with your copy of a free program.
Well, here's an example. I was talking to an IT person for the biggest grocery chain in the nation. They have, I think, 25 different chains under them. He didn't want me to say the name, but he listed and sent me documents of the German company, and then I search engined it and found the German company that's running more than half of the supermarket supply chain systems and warehouse chain systems for the food, and it's all based in Germany. They make you go through their software, through the internet and through satellites, and it breaks down every week or so for just a few hours, and everything comes to a standstill. And then he was telling me about, and I was reading about gas stations. That's why they're always shut down. And McDonald's, suddenly you can't use credit cards half the time when you're there because it's these softwares that are controlled by a company, and it lets the other companies just have a window in. Do these other big mega corporations realize the amount of power they're turning over?
I guess they don't. You see, they're not used to thinking in terms of maintaining control over their own computing. Now, this is a paradoxical case because some, you know, big companies, just by being big, have power that's dangerous to democracy. But suppose the business isn't so big. Well, then it's not dangerous. And the point is, the business is probably going to use computers, and it deserves to have control over its own computing, just as you and I do. And so they're vulnerable to this. But the propaganda of business says, just think of short-term profit. Don't think of anybody's long-term interest, not even your own. So this is why it's so common that if you let a corporation own some kind of permanent useful thing, the corporation will strip it because it's looking for short-term profit. That's one of the problems of our economic system that we have wedged ourselves into.
That's what they're doing now with the automakers. They're forcing them to sell off in pieces and literally strip mine it. What about net neutrality and how they're saying with Internet 2, you'll have a subdomain like on a MySpace or a YouTube, and that then they're going to try internet to, you know, claims their own documents, phase out individual URLs, or kind of have that be in the old internet and not upgrade the hubs for that, but then basically push everybody into the new system that, the New York Times said a month ago has less freedom but is, quote, safer.
I don't know about this, but I know a lot of people will fight it. For instance, the Free Software Foundation is not going to start posting its stuff through somebody else's server. We run our own servers. And I hope that other people will continue to do so.
So basically, the more we build the original, real, true web, so it's really a battle of architecture then, and then we choose, just like you would choose to buy organic food to then build that market so you have more choices, we choose to use the open license software and things?